This is the new Insiders episode 6. My name is Tom Jessen, and we will talk in this episode about digital manufacturing. And I will talk with my guest of today here in our studio in Amsterdam is Peter Westerink. He's from Shell. Welcome.
Thank you.
And we have also Tracy Countryman from Accenture. Hi, Tracy. How are you doing?
Hey, very good. Good to see you both. I wish I could be there in person.
Okay, that's nice. That's maybe something for after COVID. It's so nice that you are here to talk with me about this important subject. Now we have this show, and about 30 minutes, we have a panel discussion, and then we have a deep dive in this subject. But first, Tracy, can you tell us what are the key trends that you see within digital manufacturing?
Yes, absolutely. I think, had you asked me this question probably 2 years ago, kind of pre-pandemic, I probably would have said similar things, but now I think we're in a different inflection point for digital manufacturing and where it's going and the sense of urgency around it. It's been nearly a decade since Industry 4.0 or 4.0 was launched in Germany, over 10 years ago, and yet we're still sitting here today trying to figure out how we actually get after that and scale right around digital manufacturing. So there's a huge opportunity, and almost every client we look at across all industries is actually tackling this particular piece. Some of the major trends that we see that are setting us up for the inflection point now versus a few years ago due to COVID is one, the absolute need to have transparency, visibility, and agility throughout the chain. Like, how are we going to respond as manufacturers and supply chain to customer changes in demand that has just become very acute with COVID? Second, and a kind of more pervasive change that's happened through the years, but is now a challenge for us to be competitive, is the changing a customer. And I use customer loosely to include both consumers, if you're in consumer goods and discrete manufacturing, but also the B2B customers. And the changes that are coming through around mix of our products, that could be oil and gas, right? And looking at our crude slates and the complexity of the stuff that we're getting around upstream and how we use that in refining. That could be, and the mix of fuels that we need, including renewables. That could be on the consumer side and how we're driving to a customer-oriented operations to meet specific and unique aspects of what customers want to buy. I think the third thing here is really the cost competitiveness. So every year within manufacturing, we take a look at how do we get 1% more, 2% more through standard and traditional continuous improvement programs. And we're also looking at how do we get more out of the existing assets today. So yield, quality, energy optimization are all still things that are top of mind. I consider it the moment of truth where we're looking at traditional manufacturing levers, but in a new way. And that new way is how we leverage digital to drive the step change that we're looking for. Automation is becoming a hotter and hotter topic. And I don't mean just traditional automation like our level 2 and what we've been doing for years in several of the process industries, but also automation in how we do new workflows and embed intelligence with the workers using AI and new capabilities. How do we introduce robotics into how we're doing manufacturing and how we get to modular manufacturing? So automation is a major trend that's got a more expansive definition about what we're looking at in the industry. And then I would say lastly, major trend is kind of the new ways of working. Couldn't be more obvious as you guys sit there in the wonderful office there in Amsterdam, and I'm sitting in mine, and we're doing what we would do had I had the chance to be there in person. And this new way of working is absolutely transforming and putting pressure on the companies to address what they're going to do around digital manufacturing and where work gets done. We just completed a piece of research we call Race for Digital Operations, and it was perfectly timed or not, right, with the pandemic, about the maturity of scaling digital throughout the industries. And only 39%, right, of companies have moved from a pilot stage of things to large-scale cross-plant deployments, right? Which means there's a huge opportunity for us to enable a scaling of digital. And that has to be one of the top themes, regardless of industry, that we've been working with our clients on as a major trend as we move into 2021 and 2022.
Well, beautiful trends also, which Tracy, hold on, because I would ask Peter, which trends do you see? Maybe the same trends as Tracy.
Yeah, No, absolutely right. So I think, Tracy, you're spot on with a number of these important digital technologies that are going to have a profound impact on our industry, whether it's from deploying AI at scale, whether it's from bringing mobile capability to frontline workers, whether it's digital twinning to help us get better understanding of not just the operations, but the entire supply chain. So those are all trends that I really recognize. But I just, if you allow me, want to pick up on the last point that you made around new ways of working, right? And I think for all the bad things of the pandemic, of course, yeah, it's hit us all very, very hard. I think one thing it did do for digital is really give it a boost to accelerate some of these new ways of working. And you're talking about, for example, having meetings like this virtually, but actually we found that these are not just initiatives that are once-offs. Actually, we found substantially new ways to, for example, provide support to remote operations, right? So Shell operates as a global company, and we have operations around the world. We have expertise located in specific hubs. And if you look at what we've done in the last year, for example, to deploy these augmented reality helmets that folks in the field somewhere in a faraway corner of the planet would have, and then real time have folks in Houston or Bangalore and some of our expertise hubs provide insight and advice and guidance how to run that operations. That's a new business model that was absolutely accelerated during the pandemic, and which is one I think is going to be lasting, right? So the need for scaling, the need for digitalization post-pandemic is absolutely there. And for all the bad things, the one thing it did do is to boost some of those capabilities and break through some of the paradigms that existed in our ways of working.
Exactly. And what are the key drivers for Shell to invest in digital manufacturing?
Right. So I think, and Shell will be not very different from other businesses, but it's absolutely important that you invest in digital with a clear line of sight to the business outcomes that you're trying to achieve. All right, so in Shell manufacturing, it's about safety. It's about no harm to people and no harm to the environment, right? And keeping our kit in good shape every day, right? And number two, we would be looking at real-time optimization of the business, right? Because we're running a business and an increasingly complex market. You also touched on an increasingly diverse customer base who want to see different products. That's absolutely critical. The third one I would say is to have no unpredicted events, right? So one thing that the manufacturing industry sometimes suffers from is unpredictability of its assets, right? So wear and tear we cannot stop. But for example, through deploying artificial intelligence, we're able to get a much closer look on the asset health, and we can prevent unpredicted things from happening. We can prevent things, we may not be able to prevent things from happening, but we can start to get foresight. And that allows you to plan ahead of things, to keep things small, and really realize a high availability of the units. And the last thing I would say is to have a really engaged and inspired workforce who feels valued for bringing contributions to the business every single day. So those are the key objectives and the reasons why we invest in digital. And you see that we're driving programs, central programs, that are aimed exactly at those business outcomes. So I mentioned predictive maintenance already, but also around the workforce, for example, we're investing heavily in Shell in what we call a DIY, do-it-yourself digitalization, or democratizing digital. So putting data in the hands of people and allowing them to develop solutions for their day-to-day problems.
It's beautiful because Tracy and you both mentioned that focusing on value is very important. Let's talk about the return on investment, Tracy, because how can organizations ensure their return on investment?
Yeah, the ongoing discussion we have at the beginning of every strategy project, every use case that gets defined, every prototype we're about to launch, you know, I think it's critical. And Peter said it, the acute focus and very targeted and keeping to touch base around the value anticipated, value measured, value delivered, and keeping that cycle going throughout the process is key. You know, there was a point in time where the digital was kind of the cool thing, right? And what we looked at years ago was, you know, all of these fun toys, and we led the technology, to be honest. And in oil and gas, what is interesting, Peter, is oil and gas in our 10 industries for maturity was top one. In that sector. And when we look at that throughout the changes that have happened in the last few years, it's not about technology. It's about the people side, which you reference. It's about getting after the value around three core areas: operating income, both top line and bottom line, that helps with new services. Second is asset utilization, whether we call that reliability, asset performance, OEE. There's lots of different terms depending on which industry you're in. And then digitizing the product itself. So in many industries, how you derive top line and new services and revenue growth. And Tom, I think the thing that we've looked at is the investment is critical. So in the study, which was over 600 companies, we asked them the percent of their sales that they're investing in digital and the correlation to that to ROI. And what we saw is in the near term, we're talking about 2.1% of sales, right, or their revenue going to digital. So you can do the math depending on the size of your company, what that implies. And then that's in the near term. And then in the midterm, right, we go up to 3.4% roughly, right, on average of your sales and revenue. So that is not a minor investment to get after the program. There's just some core fundamental costs. But the good news is in that same survey, and actually what we've seen from clients is we're looking about a payback for about a year, right? So the return on that is a one-year payback. Once you get some of that investment in place and some of the foundations built, which is what everybody's really trying to get after.
Peter, give us an insight of the talks about return on investment at Shell.
Yeah, absolutely. So, Tracy, you're absolutely right. Right. So this is just far more than about cost cutting. It's also about top line growth. So we look at the value elements across the board, right? So we see, obviously, when you start to streamline work processes, you're going to cut out a lot of waste, and that helps your cost effectiveness, right? I think we also see, you mentioned increased asset reliability leads to higher performance of the assets. So that's clearly something that we also recognize. And whilst initially there was a lot of talk about justifying some of the products that we're doing, I see now generally across the company a belief that this is the way in which we're going to move away from that continuous improvement that you refer to, Tracy, of every year 1% better. I think folks are looking for a step change improvement in performance. I think that's also necessary in where we are in the industry. So everyone, I think there's a firm belief that digital and innovation is at the corner of that, a cornerstone for that type of transformation. So if we look within Shell, I mean, we've quoted in the past, a couple years ago, already quoting overall benefits of around $1 billion a year for RDS White, Royal Dutch Shell White. I think those numbers are only increasing. And if I look at the pace at which we're picking up digital and at the pace at which we're scaling and replicating, and maybe we come to talk about a couple of those examples later as well, I'm really excited about the future of business impact of digital.
And you also believe that Shell is part of the value makers of the future, right?
Absolutely, yeah.
Why is that? Can you explain?
Yeah, so I think if we look at how we're approaching digitalization, right, you continuously struggle, or you have to balance the funnel between things that drive the one-year payback, right? So that's that short-term payback to generate the cash and to generate the credibility for the program. And those are typically things that give you that improvement. I think we balance that with a more profound investment into the foundation, which is going to give you that transformation. And I see within Shell that we're doing both of those, right? So we are able to generate value short term, for example, through driving mobile capability with our frontline workers, for example, through all the DIY developments that we're doing, our predictive maintenance programs that are starting to pay off. And that helps us to invest in what I call the essence of the digital transformation, is to go from an analog world, which is document-centric, to a digital world, which is very data-centric. And I see that we're playing in both of those fields, and we're making those deep investments in data structure, in data governance, building the right people capability to support that in the future, and working in an industry ecosystem to develop the solutions that are necessary in that future world.
Mm, okay, let's move on to the progress, because Tracy, I believe you have three key steps that are really important for every organization. First, before you mention these three steps, why is it important to think about that?
Why is it important to think about transformation in digital.
Of course, and also about the progress, how you can take your employees with you in the company about this subject.
Gosh, the people side is the most important side. I love the do-it-yourself, Peter. I hadn't heard you guys kind of coin that term around empowering the local workforce. There are a couple of key things that you got to get right to drive the progress within a digital program. So first of all, the vision of the solutions have really unfolded throughout the years. You know, a year ago, it was robotics was hot, then it was AI, then it was IoT, then it was cloud platform. And I can remember when we were doing the refining roundtable 4 years ago now, the whole discussion was, well, what is this digital and why should we care? And I'm not sure it applies to us. And now that that's become fairly mainstream, there's a lot of maturity around the platforms and the backbone or foundation that you're referring to, Peter, in that. So one is really learning from these technologies and how you're going to industrialize those and use them within your manufacturing is number one. So what fits in what domain and which technology is best you can apply right today. Second, is it adopting it in a real world industrial enterprise? It sounds simple, but it is so difficult to get done. Scaling up digital solutions requires instilling the company entirely new ways of working and culture and user experience design and really working with the people in the shop floor. And I'm guessing, Peter, you guys have realized this, kind of the balance between what you do in central to enable innovation and then how you get the innovation from the workers and really orienting around the pain points to make the life easier and better within those workers. And so that's really, you know, getting to the enterprise balance between that and the plants. And third is, I think there's a fundamental question and things that people are balancing around the industry 3.0 status and level of maturity of their company versus the ambition and vision of really achieving industry 4. Real questions, you know, why should I be doing digital when I don't have good fundamentals? Right? How can I get after a digital program when I don't have good lean, you know, Six Sigma practices or good data or automation, just kind of modernization around the facilities that has been lacking for many years? So there's a continuous kind of, you know, pull between where you're at and you're in that and then how digital can come forward and add value today in the operations. I had an example about a year ago where we were working with an oil and gas company and I was in Australia and we were working on the digital aspects of it. We were brainstorming. We had 40 engineers. We had everybody in there. We're going to do all the use cases. We're going to transform the world. And literally one of the guys pulled me aside after the meeting and said, Tracy, like, no offense, but this is really interesting. And I'm sure we can get a bunch of ideas and we have lots of problems that we can go get after. But when we get a patch from corporate on Wednesdays, we all leave our PC because it's going to take about an hour and a half to do that. And so we can, you want to talk about digital and we got like real, you know, technology infrastructure problems and not connectivity and those kind of issues. So I think you have to be straight up about where you're at and what you need to do in your backbone capability, but also the things you can go do today to make that work life easier and move those roadblocks right out of the way.
Clear. What are your experience, Peter? Do you also see these three steps?
Yeah, absolutely right. And of course, I sit here today to tell you how great and wonderful the world is. But I'll be honest with you. So within Shell, also we've gone through that maturity curve where you start off learning about digital, and then you slowly start doing digital, and then ultimately we want to be digital, right? So we're on that path, and I see us move across from where we were 2 years ago, very deliberate and very purposeful. And it's really interesting what you said, Tracy, because we're a company of engineers as well, right? So we love technology, and one of the dangers is that you get hung up in technical capability, right? So take robotics for example, right? Everybody loves the robots, everybody loves the drones. But if you're not able to translate technical capability into business capability that's going to deliver business outcomes that I mentioned to you earlier around safety, around optimization, around availability, around an energized workforce, if you can't see that line of sight between the individual initiatives and that business outcome, you're probably going to end up at some point with a manager saying, and this is not working, I'm going to stop the funding, right? So we've been very purposeful about creating a vision that ties the technical capability to the business outcome. And I think if you do that across a large asset base, you find that actually a lot of the assets are trying to achieve the same business outcome. So that creates your narrative for scaling and replicating. Everybody needs a reliable asset. Everybody's running assets with pumps and valves that can fail. So if we have one artificial intelligence solution that gives us the insight to the health of those equipment items, we actually create a solution that can be deployed across, right? So one is around that vision that you also mentioned, Tracy. I think the second point which I see, which I think is really helping us, is to also put a clear governance structure around that, right? So making decisions about where you invest and where you don't invest, making decisions about once you invest in central programs, that you have a structure in place that doesn't leave opt-in to the assets, right? So that you don't have everybody, you have to convince everybody individually that this is a good idea, but rather flip it around and make it an opt-out. So we've decided on a central solution for availability, and now we would like each of the assets to deploy it. And if you're not going to do that for whatever reason, please come and tell us, mm-hmm. right? So that's a change of decision-making and a change in leadership that we've deployed. And I think the third thing I would say is indeed to have that long-term investment view. Right. So if you continuously go with the fashion of the day, you're going to end up chasing technologies and you're not going to be able to realize the business value. And that's going to make the folks who are investing in digital at some point wary. Right. And so having that clear vision, tying that to a long term investment plan and doing so across replicating it and scaling it across multiple assets is what I believe one of the things that helps us moving from learning digital to sort of doing digital and ultimately being digital.
Yeah. What is the most, there are also tensions about this point.
Yeah.
What is the most important one?
Yeah. No, so I think there's many tensions, but I think one of the things that folks want to do, everybody wants to solve their own problem, right? And everybody, especially a company as global as Shell operating in so many countries, that's sort of the center of the people there, right? So they're going to want to solve the problem and they're going to want to solve it in the way that they think is best. So finding a balance between global solutions that you want to replicate across the portfolio, but also giving some freedom and empowerment to the people in the asset to actually give it their own twist is something that we've tried to find a good mechanism for. And the way we have done that is to create a number of buckets. So we've got things which we say everybody should do by a certain timeline. Think about connectivity, for example. It's a critical, we take it for granted, but to have all over the world full connectivity is something that we've mandated. And then we've got things that we say, if you're going to do it, this is how you're supposed to do it, right? So if you decide as an asset you want a digital twin, then we will have for you an offering that we would like you to take once you decide to do that. And I think the third bucket is where we say, and we recognize that in your specific context, there may be problems that aren't solved by these global solutions. So we also give you that freedom to experiment, and we build the communities to share those asset-specific initiatives to be able to leverage them in other places if they're good ideas, right? Because I sit here, but I don't pretend that I have all the answers to every problem, right?
Okay. We received a question from Lotte. Thank you very much for that, Lotte. Let's take a look.
Hi, Tracy and Peter. I'm Lotte Mobach, a strategy and consulting analyst for the Industry X practice within Accenture the Netherlands. And I had a question for you concerning the impact of digital manufacturing on the workforce. I'm curious to know, in your opinion, how we can tackle the challenge of reskilling people in order to make sure that they are truly future-proof. Thank you.
Okay. Tracy, what are your thoughts?
Yeah, I think there's a really good practice that we've seen that several of our clients do, which is what we call the Digital Academy, and that takes different flavors. There is a real commitment that needs to happen on building digital fluency throughout the organization. I mean top of the house to executives who can lead by example, right, and embrace the change and learn the new methods and tools and capability to demonstrate and lead by action. The second one is then the bottoms up and how you drive digital fluency. You know, when we go to a lot of the operations and manufacturing, we kind of live in this world where we talk about it every day, right? And I would imagine in Peter's central team for digital manufacturing, they talk about it every day and we're reading constantly, but that's not true for everyone, right, in the world. And so we have to cater to what is of interest and how to bring people along in their digital fluency and understanding. There's digital tools, platforms, learning courses, curriculum. We've seen one client in Malaysia who actually did a gamification application, releasing one piece of content every single day across 30,000 people on blockchain 101, or example use case in upstream where they've used AI to solve something. So I think there's a proper investment, and that's a big part of their investment dollars for the program, is around building that digital fluency and having an academy that allows people to learn. And then the second piece that for me is really around having people do. The best way to get the adoption in production is doing user-centric design and bringing them early on in the process around identifying in within their persona, their issues, the design thinking methods, prototyping and design, constant continuous feedback so that when it gets there, they have some super users and they know how to use it and they can enhance it over time with the backlog. So I think those are the kind of two approaches that I just see as a key for reskilling within the workforce. Peter, I don't know if you want to add to that and how you're approaching it at Shell.
Peter?
Yeah, no, I think I recognize a lot of what you say. What's interesting in the question is how do we tackle it, right? And yes, we have to tackle it for certain segments of the workforce. But what I increasingly see is that folks are tackling this themselves, right? A lot of people don't need to be told by others what they need to do. So we see a huge amount of crowdsourcing and people grabbing the opportunities that the internet gives with online courses. And of course, we try to stimulate that. So the digital academies, we offer nano degrees in data science through a company called Udacity. Maybe you've heard of it. We organize boot camps. We organize hackathons. So we do create the conditions for skill development. I absolutely agree with the point you make around doing digital as well, or putting these things into practice. I think one of the most exciting things that we run, and I referred to it earlier as our DIY program, is to actually train people up and let them solve problems in their everyday life, right? So I think taking in a lot of information around data science and what that can do for you is great. Once you start to solve things for in your own personal environment, we find that to be a huge motivator for people, and it becomes sort of a catalyst for change, not just for the individual and their skills, but also the culture that we're trying to strive after, which is one far more data-centric and sort of using new digital tools to get better business outcomes.
Okay, thank you. Beautiful. Let's also bring in the question from my previous guest, Marcus Remmers from DSM. He has this question.
I'm excited to be able to ask a question. I'm particularly passionate about the question of digital transformation in the context of manufacturing. In fact, I just joined the Global Future Councils of the World Economic Forum dedicated to advanced manufacturing. So the question that I want to ask is, how do you think digital ways of manufacturing can be a means to rebuild better and contribute to the manufacturing center and to the manufacturing sector? And how do you do that in the best way?
Okay, let's start with you, Tracy.
Yeah, well, great question, Marcus. And congratulations to joining the Council at World Economic Forum, setting a lot of the standards and vision for what we think we can achieve in manufacturing. So well done. You know, I think when we talk about manufacturing, there's something we haven't mentioned quite as predominantly as it's actually coming about in our client conversations, and that's about responsible manufacturing and sustainable contributions, right? The manufacturing sectors and production sectors are one of the largest contributors to carbon emissions and environmental things. And when we look at what we can do with advanced tech and leveraging digital, the first thing that we need to be able to do is to measure, right, our impact across the value chain, which includes our footprints and production systems. We need to be able to measure it, we need to be able to monitor it, and then we need to be able to use digital. And there are multiple use cases around particularly energy optimization. We have seen many clients using digital twins to get after that energy value lever and how they can contribute more effectively in the responsible part of their business. I think the second one that's probably a bigger one around the value chain is the designing for sustainable products. And so when we think about digitizing R&D and new product introduction and returnable plastics and things like that to drive the circular bits, there's a huge digital element on how we design that, how we do control towers, and how we bring that kind of reusable materials back into production to contribute within that particular angle as well.
Okay, Peter, a quick response because time's up.
Yes. All right, so what I love about the question is that this is not just about digital being a competitive advantage, but it's actually positioned as a competitive disadvantage if we don't do this. And I would say in our industry, we have to drive more sustainable, cleaner sources of energy. So we recently launched this collaboration between Microsoft, Shell, Baker Hughes, and C3. It's called the OpenAI Energy Initiative, and it's actually looking at ways to deploy digital technologies like AI to drive that cleaner, safer, more sustainable energy system. So fully support that digital is absolutely going to contribute to a cleaner, a better energy system.
Okay, thank you. In the next episode, we will talk about trends in business, technology, and design. My guest is also someone from Ascent. And Tracy, you have a question for my next guest.
Yeah, so I had the pleasure of reading our Fjord 7 Trends. And what was interesting to me is I thought that's all customer, consumer stuff. But when I read each trend, actually, there's a total industrial lens to that. So my favorite one and the question I have for your next insider is related to, I think it's trend number 3, where it's called Sweet is the Team. And what that means is they used a quote in there in the study that said, it's not just about office workers, it's about where all work gets done. And I think we've been talking about remote operations, enablement, remote monitoring centers around manufacturing for decades, particularly in upstream mining and utilities. But it's been a light contemplation for the rest of manufacturing and kind of downstream companies. So my question to Fjord and the team is, how does that trend number 3 manifest itself in industrial work environment?
Okay, that's a really good question. Thank you very much, Tracy, for that. And thanks to you both for joining us in our studio. Peter, did you like it?
Yes, it was great. Thank you. Thank you for being here.
Okay, thank you for joining us. And Tracy, thank you too.
Glad to be here.